Hello, and welcome to Eurospy Cinema, a series where I review various movies that fit into the Eurospy category. Today, I'll be reviewing 1966's One Spy Too Many, starring Robert Vaughn and David McCallum as Napoleon Solo and Illya Kuryakin, respectively. As you can probably tell from it featuring those two, yes, this is one of the original The Man from U.N.C.L.E. movies, the third one to be exact. After the MGM lion does its thing, we're thrown into the action as we see a totally not suspicious man driving a blue truck down a dusty road. The man then radios someone to let them know he's about to steal some stuff, thus letting us know that he is a villain. He then arrives at the gates of an army base, which for some bizarre reason are completely unguarded, so it's very easy for our friend to break in. Some guards do show up then, so he throws red smoke bomb things at them in slow motion so as to dispatch them. At first I thought he was doing this instead of using a gun so that he could stay quiet, but then he steals one of the guard's guns and shoots him with it. So, what exactly was the point of the smoke bombs? Never mind, as we cut to a demonstration of the US Army's will gas, known as BG-30, which apparently will remove a person's will to fight when they are subjected to a dose of it. So, we now have the film's MacGuffin. After only 5 minutes, this is impressively tight storytelling. However, there are dastardly plans afoot, as we see that someone inside the lab is in cahoots with the villainous character we saw before, signaling to him to gas the base. As everyone rushes out of the lab in a state of frenzy, one person stays behind, a certain Mr. Alexander, who steals the BG-30 while the others are gone. Alexander then escapes the base with his henchman disguised as his driver. They then proceed to celebrate their success by opening a bottle of champagne right near the entrance to the base. We also learn here that Alexander's henchman's name is Pavis, and that Alexander intends to conquer the world, a perfectly normal aspiration for an U.N.C.L.E. villain. Inside the base, we see that the scientists have returned, finding a strange stone tablet with a large number 8 engraved on it. What, I hear you all ask, does this all mean? Following this, we arrive at U.N.C.L.E. HQ, where Napoleon and Illya are being briefed by Mr. Waverley on the action we just saw. He tells them that Alexander is a prime suspect, and so tasks Napoleon with investigating him more, while Illya is sent off to discover more about the tablet. There is a short scene here where Napoleon meets a girl, who remains unnamed until the end of the movie, so that he can get the address of where Alexander is staying. This is the first of multiple sequences with this character, which are obviously just there to pad out the runtime. So, for the purposes of streamlining this review, I'm not going to mention any more of her other scenes, as they're all pretty inconsequential. Incidentally, she's played by Yvonne Craig, who is also Batgirl. Soon after Napoleon begins his investigations into Alexander, we meet his wife, who is keen to get a divorce so that she can get back the $1 million that she loaned him. Also, I love this line by Napoleon here.
I have an appointment.
We learn nearly nothing about Alexander from Mrs. Alexander, except that according to her, he is completely crazy, which isn't particularly surprising for an U.N.C.L.E. villain. Meanwhile, Illya visits a limping professor of archaeology in Athens called Kavon. Napoleon arrives in Athens to meet up with him, but he's followed by Mrs. Alexander, who is then kidnapped by Alexander's goons. When she arrives at Alexander's house, Alexander and her have a small chat about his upcoming party, while he eats marshmallows in a creepy way, toasting them over his incense burner for some reason. Illya and Solo then visit the party that night, and Napoleon does such a good job as a spy that he is recognized by Pavis almost as soon as he arrives. Alexander then shows off his nuttiness by interrupting the party proceedings so as to play a human-sized game of chess with Napoleon. But he becomes more than a little annoyed as Napoleon beats him, despite Alexander apparently being a champion player. Alexander is so angry, in fact, that he then leaves for his personal rock quarry. We then see him there waiting for Pavis to arrive, getting increasingly angry with him and throwing a tantrum. Fair enough though, I mean the guy is apparently a millionaire, so why not throw the occasional tantrum? While this is happening, Illya, Napoleon and Tracy, which turns out to be Mrs. Alexander's name, attempt to sneak into the rock quarry because they know that Alexander is there. Tracy also tells the two that when her and Alexander were together, he went to this place really frequently, so it must be pretty important to the plot. Unfortunately, as they sneak in, they aren't quite sneaky enough, leading to a small action sequence with the trio being chased by two guards and a jeep, who appear to also have the worst aim. The movie then cuts to Illya and Napoleon waiting at the airport. There is no explanation of what happened to the rock quarry, except that they were collected by the Athens office. You know, I was actually quite intrigued by the rock quarry thing, but the film just sort of glosses over it and almost pretends it never happened, so yeah, who knows what happened there. Napoleon and Illya then return to Mr. Kavon, the archaeologist, who explains that the stone came from the Greek tomb of Spiros on the island of Minos. So our heroes head there, accompanied by Mr. Kavon and Tracy. But as soon as they arrive, they're trapped behind some stone walls. And then the walls start moving in to crush them. Is this the end for our heroes, I hear you ask? Nope, it isn't. And suddenly, one of the walls slides away and they can keep on going. Suddenly, Alexander shows up and kidnaps each member of the group, leaving just Napoleon by himself. Napoleon eventually stumbles upon the others again, and also Alexander. There is suddenly a plot twist. It turns out that Mr. Kavon was in cahoots with Alexander the whole time. Alexander then explains to his captives that the 8 on the tablet represents how he broke the 8th commandment when he stole the BG-30 Wilgas. Napoleon also explains that Alexander broke commandment number 7 when he spent time with the prince's wife at the party earlier, which explains this number 7 on the bed that they were in. Alexander then explains that he plans to break each of the 10 commandments in such a way that when he breaks the last one, he'll be able to rule the world and become Alexander the Greater. Following this, Napoleon is then strapped to a block of stone while a giant scimitar swings above him, getting closer and closer, doing a bit of a pit in the pendulum. And as if that isn't enough, Illya and Tracy are suspended above a bottomless pit, with a rope that is slowly being burnt through by a candle. Thankfully, through the miracle of having his legs not tied down very well, Napoleon gets free and saves the others just in time. The duo then return to Uncle HQ, where Mr. Waverly tells them that there is a salon that Alexander owns, which they should investigate by using Tracy as bait. We then switch to Alexander, who is on his health food farm, where he is talking to a couple of guys in military uniforms. He reiterates to them his plan of killing their president and taking control of their country, a plan which it seems they are more than happy to help him with. When Alexander comes inside his house, he has a short talk with Kavon. It seems that their friendship is starting to strain, as Alexander wants to shunt Mr. Kavon into a retirement village, but Kavon's not too keen on that idea. Meanwhile, Napoleon, Illya and Tracy head to Alexander's salon, the Grecian Urn. We also see Pavis getting his toes done here, which is a pretty neat character moment. As soon as Tracy arrives at the salon, she is taken away to Room A, where Pavis mildly interrogates her. She convinces him that she's not actually working for Uncle, and that she instead wants to tell Alexander something very important, so Pavis decides to take her to see Alexander. Meanwhile outside, Napoleon thinks something must have happened to Tracy, so he races in there, only to meet Mr. Ingo, another of Alexander's many henchmen. Okay, what is it with people who only have one name in this movie? We have Alexander, Pavis, Kavon, and now we have Ingo. Ingo immediately assumes that Napoleon is here for the full treatment, and tells him about the great importance of eating health food. But while Ingo leaves to get a few samples, Napoleon sneaks out and sees Tracy being led off by Pavis and saves her, only to be thwarted by a surprise attack by Ingo from behind. Ingo is then left to deal with Napoleon, while Pavis takes Tracy to see Alexander, despite how she just showed that she was happily working with Uncle. Oh well, suppose this is why Pavis is not the brains of the operation. There is then a pretty neat action sequence here between Ingo and Napoleon, as Ingo is one of those near-invincible henchmen, but through his cunning and agility, Napoleon is able to dispatch of him and race after Tracy. While this is happening, Tracy has arrived at the farm. After a pretty poor effort at bluffing that she had any valuable information, Alexander discovers that she was followed by Illya, so Alexander sends in his farmhand henchman. There is another fairly good action sequence here. I mean, you have to hand it to the writers, this is certainly unique. Illya manages to escape the farm equipment and creeps into Alexander's plane hangar and onto the plane, only to be caught by Kavon, who it appears is having afternoon tea inside it for some reason. Kavon returns Illya to Alexander, only for Alexander to then hand Illya back over to Kavon so that Kavon can use him for his very dodgy mummification experiments. But thankfully, Napoleon arrives just in time, defeats Kavon, and saves Illya. Unfortunately, Alexander discovers that Napoleon has arrived and quickly leaves for an embassy party, and so Napoleon and Illya follow. As soon as they arrive near the embassy, Illya and Napoleon get in a gunfight with Alexander's men. The action is pretty good here, but sadly we have to bid adieu to Pavis, who is probably one of the best characters in this film, as he is shot by Illya. Meanwhile, Alexander has arrived at the embassy and is giving a small speech before suddenly stabbing the president of this still unnamed country. A side note here, the guy who plays this president Sing Mok was Teru Shimada, the same guy who played Osato in the Bond film You Only Live Twice. Napoleon and Illya arrive with Uncle reinforcements, but they are of course too late. Then suddenly, surprise surprise, President Sing Mok, is still alive. It turns out that he anticipated this assassination attempt and wore a protective vest. His plans foiled, Alexander jumps through a window and escapes back to his health farm. Napoleon and Illya then pursue him back to the farm and see Alexander boarding a plane. The duo then pursue the plane and Napoleon manages to jump on board, only to be thrown out again by Alexander. Thankfully, he did grab a parachute while he was inside and he descends in black and white. Meanwhile, on board the plane, Mr. Kavon, who was flying it, starts to take his anger out on Alexander. Instead of attempting to defuse the situation, Alexander calls Kavon an old fool, only spurring him to kill Alexander with a knife that was hidden in his crutch. Alexander then keels over very dead, while Kavon accidentally hits the controls of the plane with his knife, causing it to suddenly explode, in black and white. Following this, we see that all is well as Napoleon and Illya have returned to the embassy party for champagne. Tracy proceeds to run off with the president, which annoys Napoleon. And Mr. Waverley shows up to remind the audience about the BG-30 wheel gas. Remember that? And how, thankfully, it has been safely returned to the army, off screen. Then, surprise surprise, it turns out that the girl at Uncle HQ, whose scenes I've removed from this review, is Mr. Waverley's niece, Maud. This doesn't seem to faze Napoleon, however, and he leaves with Maud on their date anyway, leaving just Illya and Mr. Waverley drinking champagne at the embassy. And the credits roll. That was one spy too many. Overall, it's not too bad. The film basically feels like a lower budget Bond. I mean, I know that's really not saying much considering Bond was what a lot of these Eurospy movies tried to emulate, but this one actually feels like a semi-Bondian adventure. The lower budget feeling probably comes from the fact that this film is actually the double episode The Alexander the Greater Affair from the Man from U.N.C.L.E. TV show, retooled with a few scenes removed and a few new scenes added. To be honest, I actually prefer the original episode, mainly because it doesn't have Maud in it. I know I'm probably being a bit harsh on her, but her conversations with Napoleon start to get tiresome really quickly. It's funny, as they had a bit over 90 minutes of footage from the original double episode, but they felt the need to remove the second half of the rock quarry sequence and replace it with the Maud segments. I mean, they could merely have left the double episode the way it was and shipped it as a movie. But anyway, I digress. I guess a fair amount of the Bond feel can be put down to Robert Vaughn's performance in this. I generally find Napoleon quite irritating, but in this film, he's actually toned down enough that he's pretty good. David McCallum delivers a great performance as always as Illya. His character is always great, as he's there to do the job, not get distracted by excessive fraternizing with female companions, as Napoleon often is. Rip Torn does a good job of Alexander, the marshmallow scene definitely being his best. I do like how he portrays a character getting increasingly unhinged as the film progresses. I feel like the writing of his character was just generally what let it down though. There simply wasn't enough time with the character to fully flesh out his insanity. Dorothy Proveen as Tracy does a pretty good job with what she's given. The character isn't really written as being particularly competent or interesting, however, she does have some good lines and plays off Rip Torn pretty well. David Shayner does a great job as Pavis. I love the long-suffering attitude that he brings to his character. And the beginning sequence does a really neat job of setting him up as a competent and dangerous henchman. Also, he has a great mustache. David Opatoshu is not too bad as Kavon. Someone like Alexander, I feel that he just really needed more screen time. I really like the idea of him being Alexander's Aristotle, guiding him and being the real brains of the operation, but you don't really ever see that. I do appreciate the ending though. I like how fitting it is for Alexander to be undone by the very man who built him up in the first place. And, as usual, Leo Carroll does an amazing job as Mr. Waverley. He doesn't really appear much in this film, but he does always elevate any scene he's in. The music is not too bad in this adventure. Sadly, there is no specific song or anything associated with this movie. Rather, all the scoring is simply reused pieces of the U.N.C.L.E. TV show music composed by Jerry Goldsmith and Gerald Fried. To round it off, One Spy Too Many is a pretty middling Eurospy adventure. Considering it's edited from a TV show, it features quite a few pretty good action sequences. The actors are all putting their best in and do a fairly good job of selling the suspense in places. The only main letdowns are in the script department. The plot is overly convoluted, and whole plot points are completely dropped halfway through. I mean, what happens to the BG-30? It's kind of there, and then they just sort of forget to mention it. And what about the rock quarry sequence? Plus, some characters just feel like cardboard cutouts, with really very little life having been breathed into them. However, the film does get extra credit for Pavis's mustache. Anyway, that's all I have for this episode of Eurospy Cinema, so I'll see you later. Goodbye!